thought I might make up for it today by carrying my team to victory, but these guys were a lot heavier than I expected. So maybe I can make up for it by giving you a nice talk. Next slide. Let me start by reminding you of why we don't have a cure for ALS yet. It really comes down to just these reasons. First, we don't know what causes most cases of ALS. It's kind of hard to fix something when you don't know why it happens in the first place. Second, we don't know why once people get this disease, they can't just shake it off like a cold. It just keeps getting worse. Third, it takes a long time to make a diagnosis of ALS. On average, it's about 14 months between the time that someone has their first symptoms and the day that I can tell them they have ALS. And in that time period, they lose about half of the motor neurons in their brain and spinal cord. So we're really behind the eight ball right from the start. And then finally, the ways that we measure changes in people with ALS, they're kind of noisy between patients, and they're really slow to change. And as a result of those clumsy tools, when we do a clinical trial, we need hundreds of patients, and we need the trial to go on for a year or more before we can tell if we've actually done something. Next. So let me tell you about some of the ways we're getting around those barriers. First of all, genetics. So this is a graph that shows gene discovery by year. And what you can see is that we discovered the first ALS-causing gene, SOD1, in about 1994. And then for years, we didn't discover any more genes. And then they started to trickle in. But really, over the past couple of years, we've had an explosion. In fact, we've learned of four new genes just in the past year. And when you add all these genes together, we can now explain about 15% of the people that come to my clinic why they got ALS, about 15% of them. Next. So that's good, but we still have 85% of people whose ALS we can't explain. So how are we going to figure that out? Well, it's safe to say that most of them probably don't have a gene that's causing their ALS. We would have figured that out by now with the tools that we have. It's probably coming from something in the environment, and it might not even be just one thing. You might need to have multiple exposures to get ALS. And so I'm excited to tell you that we have a tool that we've been working on for several years called the National ALS Registry. It's the largest, most expensive ALS study that's ever been done. And it's starting to release results. So just a couple months ago, we got the first results out of there that told us how many people in the United States have ALS. And over the next few months, we're going to get results that tell us where these people live. So we'll be able to see if there's hotspots of ALS around the country. And Jerry and I have talked about the fact that I'm kind of worried that there might be a hotspot in the mid-Atlantic part of the United States. It just seems like we have way too many people with ALS in North Carolina. It doesn't make sense. The other nice thing that's going to come out of this is we have risk factor modules. So we're learning about the lives of people with ALS. We can look backwards over their lives and figure out what was it that was different about it that might have triggered their ALS. And we've already got some inklings about this. A couple of really interesting things. One is people that get ALS are about twice as likely to have played a varsity sport over the course of their lives compared to people who don't get ALS. The other is people who get ALS are more likely to have been lean throughout their lives. Obese people are protected against ALS. And so for those of you that have seen me speak for the last few years and you wonder why I'm letting myself go, this is part of the reason. Next. So that's the stuff about cause. Now what about progression? It'd be really nice to figure out what caused ALS, but even if we figured that out tomorrow, we'd still have a whole bunch of patients, 400 in my clinic alone, that have it and keep getting worse. Why are they getting worse? So we figured out in the last few years that the cells that live next to motor neurons may be the key to this. So in the middle of this picture is a motor neuron. And we've been targeting the events inside that cell for 100 years and trying to figure out what's wrong and how to fix it. Well, in recent years, we've developed this technique. We can make animal models of ALS now, and we can genetically rescue whatever cell type we want. So we can make those animals have genetically normal motor neurons and leave every other cell genetically abnormal. And guess what happens? They progress and die from ALS just as if we did nothing at all. So it seems like genetically rescuing motor neurons doesn't do anything. But if we genetically rescue this guy, he's called a microglia, or this guy called an astrocyte, we can make these animals live several weeks longer. It doesn't sound like much, but the best drug we've ever studied in animals prolongs survival by a few days. And that translates out to months in people, so weeks could translate out to years. And maybe most exciting of all is this cell, which is called an oligodendrocyte, another neighboring cell. When we genetically rescue that cell, the animals live 6 months longer. That could translate into decades in people. And we're starting to understand specifically what's wrong with these cells now. We know the microglia, they're squirting toxic chemicals onto the motor neurons. We know the astrocyte has stopped sucking up toxic chemicals, in particular one called glutamate. And we know that this oligodendrocyte has stopped shuttling an energy-producing substance called lactate into the motor neuron. So it's only a matter of time now before you start to see trials targeting those cells. Next. All the stuff I just told you comes from animal models of ALS, and those are based on genetic abnormalities. We don't know if what we learn from those models is going to translate into people who don't have abnormal genes. So we need models of people with sporadic, non-genetic ALS. How do you make a model of something when you don't know what caused it? Turns out we might have a way. We have a technique now which is called induced pluripotential stem cells. So we can scrape the skin of a patient with ALS and treat those cells with a virus and turn them into stem cells. And treat those stem cells with chemicals and turn them into motor neurons, microglia, astrocytes, and oligodendroglia. So we can get some of the key cells from the brain and spinal cord of people with ALS without even doing an operation, just by scraping their skin. So hopefully there'll be some exciting things that comes out of that in the next year or two. Next. Diagnosis. Two things to tell you about that are very exciting. First of all, our imaging techniques are getting much better. So we've got a version of MRI now, which uses a magnet to image tissues like the brain and spinal cord. It's called DTI. And with this technique, we can actually measure the thickness of bundles of upper motor neurons in the brain, called the corticospinal tract. So these are those bundles in a patient without ALS, and these are those bundles in a patient with ALS. And it may not look like there's much of a difference between those two, but if you ask a computer to subtract one from the other, there's a huge difference. So we can actually measure the loss of upper motor neurons now with MRIs. The other thing is we've got a company out there called Amorphix, and they're telling us that they think they have a blood test that we might be able to do to diagnose ALS in people. So hopefully over the next year, we'll be cutting down the time that it takes to diagnose this disease a lot. Next. And then finally, this business about noisy outcome measures. So we've got something now which is called electrical impedance myography. It takes a small electric current and it passes us through a targeted muscle. So say, for example, we pass it through the biceps. The amount of resistance that that electric current encounters is proportional to how thick the muscle is. In other words, this is an electrical measure of muscle atrophy. Okay? What does it do for us? Well, over here, you see the different outcome measures that we have in ALS and how many patients it takes to do a trial using that outcome measure. So to use the ALS functional rating scale, which is usually what we do in clinical trials, it takes 220 patients in each group. Normally when we do a study, we have two groups. One group gets the experimental drug, the other group gets a placebo. So 440 patients for a clinical trial. When we use EIM, we need less than 100, 95 patients in each group. So what does this mean? It means that very soon we'll be able to do trials and get them done a lot faster, get answers a lot faster, get to a cure for ALS a lot faster. Next. Meanwhile, while all these things are going on, we're still continuing to do clinical trials. So this is kind of a roadmap of where our clinical trials are. In the middle here is a motor neuron, and we see some of the neighboring cells, the astrocyte over here, the macrophage over here. We've got trials now that manipulate genes. We've actually got a way to turn off abnormal genes. It's called antisense oligonucleotides. We've got a way to deal with some of the power plant troubles, the energy production troubles that this cell has, by targeting the mitochondria. We've got a way to target these microglia now with two different drugs that are in trials, one called NP001 and one called gelinia. And maybe most exciting of all, we're starting to see trials of stem cells. So there's lots of different things that stem cells might be able to do. One, might be able to actually replace some of those damaged cells. Two, stem cells might be able to secrete growth factors that keep these cells healthy longer. Next. So this is probably my most exciting slide. It's brand new. So we've got a stem cell trial going on right now. It's called the neural stem trial. And in this trial, embryonic stem cells are injected with a needle in the operating room into the spinal cord of patients with ALS. And so as you can imagine, the FDA has made us go very slowly with this trial because we've never done anything like this before. We weren't sure what was going to happen. The good news is we've done it in 30 people. It doesn't seem to cause any harm. And these are the results. And I want to point out one of the patients here, which is this purple line. So this is the ALS functional rating scale in this patient before the stem cells were injected. It's going down. The patient is losing functions. After the stem cells, a dramatic improvement in what the patient can do. This is the grip strength in the left hand and the right hand, going straight down like it always does in ALS before the stem cells. After the stem cells are injected, a dramatic improvement. This is the first time in history that we've seen a patient with ALS in a clinical trial who's actually getting better, regaining functions that they had lost. Next. Now it's important to remember that when we see somebody with ALS who's getting better, which is called an ALS reversal, we don't know for sure that it's the thing that was being done to them. Believe it or not, very rarely there are people with ALS who progress for a while and then get better. I've seen it myself twice. I know it happens. Nobody has ever thought it would be worth studying those patients because they're too few and far between. Well, we're going to use some of the money that we got at Duke from the Ice Bucket Challenge to start a program called ALS Reversals. We're going to try to see if there's something different about the immune system or the genetics of these people that allowed them to beat the disease. Now, it might seem like a long shot, but if you've been watching the news this week, you might have seen this headline. In HIV, there are a group of people called elite controllers. These are people that have been known about for 20 years. They get infected with the HIV virus, but they never get AIDS. And in fact, in many of these people, when you look years later in their blood, you can't find any evidence of the virus. They beat AIDS by themselves, okay, without the help of any drugs. This week, scientists figured out the gene that allows them to do that. This is huge. This might revolutionize HIV treatment, and we might be able to do the same thing with ALS. Anyway, I hope you realize that none of this exciting stuff would be possible without people like you coming out to events like this and helping us to raise money. I always use the quote by Margaret Mead, "Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can work together to make a difference." In fact, that's the only thing that ever does. Thanks for coming out and golfing today. Your efforts are helping us make a difference.